So instead of asking about all that we just examined on how to inherit eternal life, the lawyer simply asked for clarification on who is his neighbor. All we know of his motivation is that it was to test Jesus. But it may also have been a way for this man to avoid the clear teaching of God's word given to us through the ages. Without any hesitation, Jesus takes this lawyer's question, no matter his motive, and sets us all straight as to who is our neighbor by telling this short but simple parable. Who is our neighbor? Jesus replied, "A man going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now a priest was going down that road, and when he saw the hurt man, he passed by on the other side." Here we have a holy man of God in this story is a person a Jewish audience would likely think to be the guy who surely would stop and care for this man in distress. But this is not how Jesus is telling it. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw the hurt man, he passed by on the other side. Again, a man who is an assistant to a priest is even more unwilling to help. So much that he moves to the other side of the road to pass by the injured man and not stop to help him. We could try and speculate about the reasons these men did not stop to help. But the real point is that Jesus is telling this parable to teach us the truth. It does not matter why these two men did not stop, but the simple fact is that they did not stop and help the hurt man. Once again, Jesus turns the tables right side up on the lawyer, the crowd, and us, moving us all in the right direction to make the hero of the story the one who is not an Israelite, but who is a member of a people group despised by the Jews. This presses the lawyer and us into a realm we are not as inclined to go on our own. A Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where the injured man was, and when he saw the hurt man, he had compassion. He went to him and bound his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. He then set the hurt man on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back." This Samaritan man went the full measure in caring for this injured man, whose origin is unknown. And it seems to have not mattered to the Samaritan. He cared for the man himself and made provisions for his continued care when he needed to leave. He provides a great example for each of us on what it means to be a neighbor and to love one's neighbor as yourself. Let me take a brief moment to tell a story from my childhood that has made a lasting impact on me. It provides a simple example from one's everyday life of who we are to see as our neighbor, to love and show mercy for the glory of God. It's a story that touches deep to my heart, and every time I try to share it with others, it affects me. I'll try to get through. As a young boy around 8 years old, living in the small suburban borough of Sharmanstown, not too far from here, I saw a young woman who appeared odd and initially a bit scary to me. She would awkwardly pull her little cart of housewares door to door in our small neighborhood to sell. Her strange appearance and impeded speech made it hard for many of us to easily welcome this invited visitor, and we were too easily inclined to make fun of her. She strangely had to hold her one eyelid open with her hand in order to properly see her customers. One day when this lady came to knock on our front door, I watched my mom's encounter with her. From first to last, my mom was unaffected by this person's abnormalities, but greeted her with compassion and loving care. this lady visits to my mom. This lady greeted her. This lady returned several times while we lived there. During each of her visits, my mom made it a point to buy something from her, to show her compassion, to respect, and to wish her well upon her day. Much to my surprise, I eventually learned that this lady is Isabel, who some 10 years earlier had for a short time been a patient from a mental hospital, whom my mom cared for as a nurse. My mom had prepared her for surgery to deal with a tumor around her eye. God used this simple act of love of my mom for compassion and mercy for my dear Isabel, unaffected by her unpleasant appearance and awkward mannerism, to make an early and lasting impression on me of how to love my neighbor as myself to the glory of God. So following his brief story, Jesus asked the lawyer for his thoughts on who is his neighbor. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? The lawyer answered, the one who showed mercy. And Jesus said to the lawyer, you go and do likewise. It is valuable to note the lawyer's original question is not the same one that Jesus at the end of the story asked the lawyer. The lawyer had asked Jesus, who is my neighbor? But instead, Jesus asked the lawyer, which of these proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? Again, Jesus teaches what the student needed to learn, not what the student thinks he needed to learn. The lawyer's feeble attempt to test Jesus by asking, who is my neighbor that I am to love as myself, leads him to better understand and be challenged on how to be that neighbor who is to love his neighbor as himself. Which of these proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? The one who showed mercy. Go and do likewise. Even though it is not directly answered here in this passage, I believe the answer to the lawyer's question, who is my neighbor, is still a valuable question for us to have answered here. In truth, everyone we meet is our neighbor, regardless of sex, social status, skin color, physical appearance, political affiliation, language, or whatever we could put there. Jesus calls each of his followers to be a good neighbor as described in this parable, to care for others as God deserves them to be treated. Please hear that again. We are to care for others as God deserves for them to be cared for. We know the golden rule, that is, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. But I think this even takes it a little bit further, that we are to think of how we are to treat one another as unto the glory of God. Not what they deserve from our estimation, but what God deserves. Through ministry to state, the Presbyterian Church in America has called me to serve as the state capital minister for Pennsylvania. In an ever-increasing way, I have come to see each member of the state and house, of the state house and senate, along with their staff, as my neighbors, whom I am called to love as myself for the glory of God and Jesus Christ. By God's grace, I have come to see them not so much as Democrats or Republicans, but as people. People who are my neighbors in need of the loving touch of Jesus Christ through me, and the reality of truth, of his truth, by my words and actions. And I have been given this calling And part of that calling is to ask if you, in this congregation, as I travel around the state and I'm trying to ask and pray for every last believer in Pennsylvania to join me in putting some of your personal life focus as a good neighbor unto those serving in our civil government here in Harrisburg and in your own House and Senate districts. Would you consider joining me in seeing with new eyes the 203 members of our State House of Representatives and the 50 senators of our State Senator as your State Senate, as your neighbors needing your attention, needing your love, needing your concern, needing your personal care? The reality is that what each of us need most in this world and in the next is to be at peace with God and Jesus Christ. Not this or that law or this or that policy, but eternal fellowship and peace with God through the great and gracious work of Jesus Christ, taking upon himself the sin of his people and mercifully placing his righteousness upon his people through the power of the Holy Spirit unto the glory of God. I am seeking God's face for a great revival and reformation throughout the body of Christ in Pennsylvania that will manifest itself in an outpouring of showing God's love in Jesus Christ and speaking his truth to those serving in our civil government. As I close, I am using a well-known but always applicable first question and answer to the Heidelberg Catechism as a wonderful declaration and reminder that Jesus Christ is the very best neighbor you could hope for, who is always good and caring to his beloved people of God. The question is, what is your only hope in this life, only comfort in life and death? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Because of that summary, so clearly stated, of our relationship with God in Christ, therefore let us go and do likewise for the glory of God in Jesus Christ and for the furthering of his kingdom, relying completely and fully upon the great and awesome work of Jesus Christ, accomplished for his people in love and mercy and applied to his people by the power of the Holy Spirit. May we be willing to expect great things from God and be willing to attempt great things for God.